first certain topics that inspire me, because I think it's this invitation comes after an intuition about my connection with sorcery. So I'm not here to convert you into sorcery, I'm not interested in that at all, but I think it can be an interesting it can be interesting to show you how certain point of views can affect the practice of someone else. So that not everything is, it's not that sorcery is irrational, but there are certain elements that can really, really feed the world, the anti-world someone tries to build through art. And this is a very famous image. It's an image from The Exorcist, that is a very cult movie for me. And the reason why I like it, even if it's not my style of movie, is because, first of all, it is centered on female presence. Then the woman, in this case, in the case of the exorcist, the woman that is possessed is very young, and this is a typical stereotype in culture. So that the woman is possessed, but usually she's young, so she's not that aware of what is happening. But indeed, the exorcist took inspiration from other events, people that were spoken by voices or presences or whatever, we can, I would call it. But in general, the possessed person wasn't that young. So this is just a representation. But still, I like this idea of the surreal aspect of this presence. And in general, I really, really like antagonists. Women antagonists, then metaphysics, and this and also the very, very original way that demons and devils use the performative aspect of that. I really like it. Like, for example, who are you? And usually the demon never really answers the question. So it's never really dialectical, a conversation with the demon. It's always a disappointment. We are many. It can be an answer. And so I'm very fascinated by this way of rediscussing stereotypes and cultural stereotypes. And this is also another very famous scene from The Exorcist. So someone walking counter-sense, we say counter-grain. So counter-culture in general. Counter-culture and unexpected subject. What you cannot, what is unpredictable. And well, yes, I also like nightgowns. This is an interesting topic for me as well, and the culturization. It is not a cultural revolution which follows and integrates a structural revolution, nor one based on the validation at all levels of an ideology. It affirms the lack of any need for ideology at all. Oh, I'm not going to fix you, John, or any of you people. And then here is an explanation, Middle English. I can't see. Denoting a non-cultivated piece of land, the noun from French, de culture, or directly from Latin, de cultura, de cultivazioni, the verb from obsolete French, and here is all the origin of this word. And this is a picture from the Middle Age, representing Eve on the side, which has been basically the protagonist of art history and culture. So the way we imagine woman. And on the on the left-hand side, Lilith. Lilith is the character that was somehow banned from from the Torah and from the all the Testament and from the Bible. So there is no trace of Lilith, but indeed she was the first woman was indeed Lilith. And Lilith is considered a very powerful demon. Obviously, I speak of this character as symbols, not as presence themselves. But symbols have power. And Lilith is called is supposed to bring bad luck into houses because she protects abortion. So she's the mother of abortion. Abortion and masturbation. So this is why she's strongly connected with witchcraft. Because in popular culture, all very, very old popular culture, when someone did masturbation, the demon possessing the person, the demon that somehow rules your imagination during masturbation is indeed Lilith. But this being mother of abortion, mother of masturbation, indeed it's also a way to represent a mother who is a mother of a creation, and not only procreation. So that is not just the human beings are the only those who are only world in world. So being the mother of abortion means also being mother of every creature, and not just a certain type, a certain race in this world. And here, she's represented as the one who was indeed the snake. And here you see her crowned. So still, this is Middle Age representation of someone. So the crown represents a crowned person is someone who is a ruler of the world. So she's the mother of the anti-world, and she's crowned. So she's really, really a queen. She makes her own world. And then she has a tail, like a snake. So this female being that is very, that she doesn't want to dominate nature, but she wants to be part of that. And also she has the wings, so she's able to fly as the girl in The Exorcist. So a representation of this being open to other things, not only reality. So the wings stand for this. And the apple is a symbol that we all know. It's about wisdom. And I would say that she's my muse. My main muse is Lilith. This is a still from The Pleasure Dome of Kenneth Anger. In this moment, Cameron, artist and occultist, has a little creature on her hand. This creature is an elemental, is a representation, and Kenneth Anger is representing this mental status, the creation of an elemental. Elemental is a little demon that lives next to the sorcerer and is supposed to be a helper of the sorcerer. There is a lot of popular representation of this, but indeed the elemental represents one part of the brain of the creator. So the elemental, this kind of a little demon belong to an idea of the individual as not only one person, but many people all together in one. And I'm very fascinated by this destruction of the ego and the chance of opening yourself to different facades, so not giving the identity for something granted. And in elemental magic, the main practice is to create these alter egos of yourself and being able to command them. So being able that these presences are not really free to do what they want, but to be aware of them. And so this is the main principle of demonology. This is, I've just copied and passed this. This belongs to the Salomon book, the Clavicula. And it's the invocation of Lucifuge Rofocal, that indeed is supposed to be the darkest entity of hell. And I must say, I find it very, very cute. And I also like, see here, I judge you, O spirit, by the power of the grand, blah, blah, how this big, dominant presence, this big name, these are name of potence, these are power names in a ritual, okay? And here are all the words that are supposed to express the power of the magician when the magician finally decides to face this entity, so to invoke and, I will say, open up in your brain a door towards this very, very extreme darkness. After a second repetition of these sublime and powerful words, you may be sure, as the position affirms, that the spirit will respond after the ensuing moment of the manifestation of the spirit. And this is the answer of one of the most important demons during a pact with the demons. Lo, I'm here. What do you seek of me? Why do you disturb my repose? And smite me no more with that dread rod. I like this irony that comes from what is above. There is a lot of irony in chaos. Chaos is ruled by it, rather than the traditional way of imagining this other world as forces that are always above you and you cannot deal or dialogue with. So I like the irony that is, the irony and the wisdom that is usually connected with demonology. And now I speak about my practice. So these were some elements that I find significant in relation then to my practice. This is a photo of my installation at Contour 7. It's the Book of Evil Spirits. It is a film where I have included my main performance. I'm a performance lecture-based artist, and I've done a lot of these live works. But since I was often putting myself in a position against the spectator, I really, really don't like this idea of being, how can I say, be kind with the spectator, or somehow indulge in a certain manner. I really like to be in a position against what is the spectator. And so in the past I did a work called Der Hexenhammer, where I was using Ulrich Meinhof spirit, so guiding a group of people inside an exhibition. Then I did a freak show using a radical feminist manifesto. Shut up, actually talk. This happened during Documenta. So this Italian radical feminism became a freak show within a very important institutional show. Then I did also another work in the Querini Stampaglia in Venice, where I was introducing the Renaissance collection, the portrait of women of the Renaissance collection, and using the silence of these women, using counterbalancing it with a text that belongs to feminist tradition as well, but if we can call it tradition, indeed it's not counterculture. But a very, very extreme text, an anonymous text written by a terrorist. And I haven't produced documents except in one case, because it was in the Querini Stampaglia. So I've been creating a lot of storytelling, so performance based on work. Then I tried to avoid the most I could the diffusion of documentation, except in the case of my performance lecture. So I wanted to create a film that included all these experiences. And so I invited a longtime friend of mine. Before I show you the film, I will explain who she is, and then we will see the film. This woman is Eusapia Palladino. She's another big love for me after Lilith. She was a 19th century psychic. And she came from the south of Italy, where I come from. And she was not able to write or read. But at a certain point, the legend says that at a certain point she was a cleaning lady. But objects started breaking in her presence. And in a very short time, she made a career as a very, very important psychic. But not the kind of psychic that takes advantage of your pain, family pain. So not that kind of psychic. She was the kind of psychic that really made a kind of show in the sense, and also used a lot of tricks. Eusapia was able to do something like a 97 number, at least this is what is reported. So I also like the fact that this way of playing with a missing documentation of her activity. See, here, for example, there are some photos, but these are it's clear that these are made up photos. So I don't provide you a real document, but I provide you a performance staged for the camera. And then she was also the wife of a man who had a shop for stage magician, which was something for me. So she had the special shoes in order to make a table levitate. Then she had this table that is examined here, is indeed made of a very, very, very light wood. I don't know, I don't remember the name in English, call it balsa. And the usual trick of the medium was to have a special ring that can catch a nail on the table and light it. And then there were also rumors about the fact that she had a little helper under her legs. I know.
But she staged the photographs.
Yes, she and probably many people I think were helping her. Yeah. But basically, she was a very big name in mediumship, but very big. Here, this is my favorite. The hand coming out of the black curtain. Mm-hmm. So she's a proto-performance artist. So you have the spiritual world, but also done with joy. Not just as something to be afraid of or something to... I like this, and a lot of scientists studied her, and all the reports are amazing, because some are telling that I'm so impressed, and then the report after that, she was found with using all these tricks, So sometimes they wanted to tie her, and but then she was found cheating. But then she would have said that she cheated because she didn't want to disappoint the scientist. So I love her. I love her. I've never seen something like that. So for in order to channel all my past performances, that made mostly art works from 2012 until now, I decided to invite her. So to use her, this also, I'm sorry, this is wonderful. She goes into a trance, and here is the representation of the ghost over her. Isn't this beautiful? And what about the man there watching it? So I take a picture of my performance, and I also show you the public attending. And these are very, very famous doctors, very famous Italian. So I also, Charles Richet studied there. A lot of important people, the Curie, they went to Eusapia's performances. So this is her. This is another work I did on her. But I wanted to, this is a movie that is nearly, it's 20 minutes, so let's see, maybe we see something, then I comment on that, or, let's see how it goes. And so in the Book of Evil Spirits, indeed it's not a book, it's a seance, where during this seance, all my ghosts, so my performances are channeled by Eusapia. And there is a person that is commenting on what is happening, so like a scientific record. And this person is a scientist himself, so he's a flamboyant. And it's a kind of a chaotic way of presenting my past. I will stop sometime to comment. No.
Okay. Her first mediumistic manifestations began at the age of puberty, when she was about 13 or 14 years old. This coincidence is found in almost all the cases in which the singular power of producing movements at a distance has been observed. At this epoch of her life, it was remarked that the seances to which she was invited succeeded much better when she was seated at the table. It was only in her 22nd or 23rd year that the spiritualistic education of Eusapia began.
And she's a character from Documentas.
Seance of September 26.
A dark bust moves forward upon the table, coming from where Eusapia sits. Then another, and still another. They look like Chinese ghosts. I am able to perceive the dimensions of these singular images, and above all, their thickness. All these busts are busts of women, of life size. But, although vague, they do not look like Eusapia. They sink down and vanish. This rigidity makes me think of reproductions or a facsimile of a bust escaped from a sculptor atelier, and I murmur, one would think he was looking at busts molded in papier-mâché.
No, not papier-mâché. In order to prove you that it is not the body of the medium, I'm going to show you a man with a beard. Attenzione.
I sit next to you, you say to me. Forget the exchanges which involve the inconvenient, unpredictable, shifty responses of another person. I agree. I do not know why we are here, but I'm pretty sure that it is not in order to enjoy ourselves.
This discovery of a spirit head in the party is so astonishing, so impossible to admit without a sufficient verification. It is not the head of the man whose profile I perceived, and the beard I felt on my hand is not there. The imprint has a resemblance to Eusapia's face.
Maybe that's because I have no history.
When Flammarion explains about the Zapia, I'm using a report that really exists. So she used it to produce this kind of counterfeit of documentation of the sense. And she was using the darkness in order to put her face on the clay, then move the face and produce this kind of, she said, this ectoplasm. And in some science museum that I've studied Eusapia's phenomena, you can find this. And then if you compare a picture of her with the ghost that left this trace in the sand, they really look the same. And I find this very, very beautiful. And while this hand belongs to another work, the one of the Querini Stampale. So we will see a bit of that also later. So it's a monologue using sign language.
Pilgrims, in the domain of Our Lady, be decently dressed. Gentlemen, let's announce cover. Ladies, a dress, head announce covered. Sports clothes are not suitable for a pilgrimage. Do not smoke. Remember where you are. Absolute silence in the church, in the grotto, in the bath.
Some have noticed that Eusapia prepared herself for the seance by reducing her respiration, a very singular thing. At the same time, her pulse gradually rises from 88 to 120. A series of varied expressions passes over her face. Sometimes it takes on a demonical look, accompanied by a fitful laugh, very much like that which Gounod gives to Mephistopheles in the opera Faust, and which almost always precedes an important phenomenon. Eusapia is not hypnotized. She enters of herself into the trance state.
Mio caro, meno luce.
Who said culture is the sublime? It is the sublime of you want to participate,
but without existing on your own.
Oh, ultimately you are unrecognizable.
And in the meanwhile, you feel in a way. You claim solidarity because you want to fight.
To my mind.
And what about
the private police?
The price is falling.
So I can stop here. Explain. This character is called Zalmagra, and she is pronouncing that this manifesto called "I Say I," beautiful yo, that was written by Carla Lonce in the 70s, and it's a manifesto about the complexity of this post-self-awareness self. So it's the woman attacking the idea of woman. And I found it very beautiful when I read it. And but at the same time thought that it would be interesting, a totally different kind of representation, so not the bourgeois woman attacking herself, but rather the freak and the witch. It's a very, very powerful image. Also because it helps you to represent how certain things are nowadays sometimes perceived. So very often, many ideas connected with this position of subversive position has been is now maybe considered outdated, no? Outdated, unnecessary, just maybe generated by a form of misbehavior or whatever. While I think there are a lot of the way of women is very, very long. For the creation of a different world, together also with men and other also other species. So I wanted to represent this, how we stigmatize radical position, and at the same time even give some a different form of power. And this is a kind of video version of the performance. Indeed, the live one was very direct and was attacking also the public, because at a certain point she was doing a kind of performance lecture, and then at a certain point she was in, who says that ideology is also my advancement, and spitting on the floor, and people were really, really afraid of that. So
may I just ask, how do you understand the private as political?
Mm-hmm.
Because I was thinking it also has these two meanings,
yeah.
In terms of private parts, and when you would beginning with your intro and you were talking about masturbation and abortion.
Well, yes, no, but I think within that context of Carla Lonce, the private is political, I think she was laughing about the fact that the personal is indeed very political and should be more the gender issue should be more taken in consideration, I think, but I'm not a philosopher.
Okay.
I mean, I'm just someone who takes inspiration from things. Then my own position in my personal life, I don't have much to comment on that. I think it's about the personal, the gender, as something, as a political entity, I think.
Okay.
Perhaps because everything I see as being my history appears otherwise to me, like a suit of clothes put on my back.
She leans her head upon the shoulder of her neighbor and curls caresses when she believes that he's sympathetic. During this time, her legs and her arms are in a state of marked tension, almost rigid, or even undergo convulsive contractions. Sometimes a tremor goes through her entire body.
Reportedly, Eutapia uses her sexual charms in an attempt to seduce the scientific investigators, who are all men. The two investigators who have supported her mediumship, Charles Richet and Cesare Lombroso, were both known for sleeping with Paladin.
These movements may be attributed to the hysterical crisis which then agitated her, but they appear to be necessary to the production of the phenomena. The head with a beard, which we saw, was of life size. It is impossible to understand how Eusapia could have hidden in her pockets or under her clothes any kind of a cardboard profile. Nor can one understand any better how, unknown to us, she could have taken out this paper figure, mounted it upon a stick or upon a wire, and so operated with it. The seance then continued in the dark. The two portières of a great double folding door against which the medium was seated, her back to the door, were blown about for nearly an hour.
Now it's Ulrike Meyer.
Is there a spirit there? Does it wish to communicate?
Good morning, Mrs. Palavin. The idea to write you came to us as we were reading the Neue Review dated May the 7th and 14th, in which you describe your life as an empress. We have the impression that as a Persian, you are not sufficiently informed about your country, and therefore you also misinform the German readers of this magazine. You say, summer in Iran is very hot, and like most Persians, I travel with my family to the Caspian Sea. Like most Persians. Isn't that exaggerated? In Baluchistan or Meran, for instance, most Persians are dying from inherited syphilis. And most Persians are farmers with a yearly income of less than $100. And most Persians lose every second child, 50 of 100. They die from hunger, poverty, illness. What about the children who not capped 14 hours daily work? Do they travel to the Persian Riviera by the Caspian Sea? But you are still young, Mrs. Pallavi. You are only 28. You will have 2 years ahead of you, which one can only end in Iran.
This text is an excerpt from another performance, as I said, Drex and Hammer, the channeling, the most significant, I would say, words by Ulrike Meinl. So from the beginning, this was the letter to Paradiba, it is a very important letter, very beautiful against the Persian empress. And then there is a second passage when she starts, when she writes about setting fire in department stores, and then there is another passage where she, where the public, this was happening in live performance. This ghost was visiting the person, and you could get in the logic of the in the passage of all these texts. So from the letter to Paradiba, that was a letter to a magazine in order to make the Empress understand that she's not really free to tell lies about her country, until one of her last texts that was in a sitting of the Rav, where she ordered her comrades to attack every American establishment. And I am also very fascinated by Ulrike Meinhof and how her trauma has been, is a totally different approach, of course, is from exactly, but how the trauma is, in her case, is also connected with this idea of Ulrike Meinhof for being crazy. Do you know this? That no one has ever discussed is if, for example, Andreas Bader, that was the partner of Ulrike Meinhof in the Bader-Meinhof group, was crazy. But the fact that bourgeois woman, expert journalist, very well-known woman of color, decides to go underground and embrace terrorism, which, of course, I'm not giving moral attributes to this. It's not that I promote RAF. But the fact that this choice was done with a lot of lucidity is not really perceived. So the original performance that then has been transformed in this apparition comes from this, from performing the most important text of Ulrike Meinhof from the beginning as a just journalist until the end, when she was imprisoned and advised her comrades to commit crime. And yes, that's it. And this was just a little part of But in the original performance, I'm not dressed with the, I mean, it's myself, normal self. Here in the film, I decided to represent them just with the eyes. So this is everyone.
Her experiments are not planned. And contrary to the habit of prestidigitators, she does not carry any apparatus upon her person. We tried to obtain words by means of the alphabet, but without success. I will remark in this connection that Eusapia knows neither how to read nor to write.
Then this also, I don't know if it's...
The first result of the seance was to establish the fact that the hypothesis of a confederate is inadmissible and ought to be entirely eliminated.
Since he is not sure, take my two hands yourself again.
No fraud possible. Eusapia acts alone.
I can't get off me. So then I start to think about the act of fragmenting myself.
And this with the hand is the anonymous text, I told you.
If I don't recognize my rage,
a devoted pilgrim kneels holding a candle in hand, its flame expanding from her fingertips to palm. We leave the pilgrims that don't record our miracle. We walk countersense to celebrate our third.
Only the independent minds, free from the classic leading strings which tie the dogmatists to their chairs, dare to study extra scientific facts or consider them possible.
Your invention of the theory of a rotative fluid causes vividly to mind the explanation of the dormitive properties of opium.
It is impossible to more completely misunderstand things. I do not say the tables turn because my fluid is rotative. I say the tables turn because when they receive an impelling force or undergo an attraction, they cannot help turning. I should be under no obligation to undertake the cause of the poor university scholar of the malade imaginaire. And defend his famous reply. Opium puts people to sleep because it has the sleep-producing virtue. In other words, I see the facts and don't know the causes. I do not know. I do not know.
This is the last ghost.
I do not know.
And here is reenacting my first piece.
I do not know.
And I'll tell you more about this piece after.
I do not know.
Από το βράδος το πρωί How do you feel?
Here?
Yeah, sure.
No, do you feel like you want to talk more about other works, or are you up for questions?
No, I think, I mean, the experiment of this film is also about creating a film with other works which are not connected all together, and only a seance, which is the space of the unconscious, can really give a narrative to that. So it's more an experiment and a symbol of what I've done before. But I think that each piece of that I've, in this case, I've explained to you what they are. Then I also forgot to mention this bearded lady was also a character in my documentary show, and she was reading letters about the gender issues. So these extracts that she's reading are a text that someone has written for my piece. But I think it's very, very dense, because you have Ulrike Meinhof, Carla Lonzi, anarcho-feminism, then anonymous message with a hand, and then the anarchist singer at the drug. So I think it's already a lot of material. Maybe I can show you just a picture, just to have an idea of
how it was installed. Maybe this video was
no, just in a video in the chapel, mm-hmm. and also in a gallery in London. But now I'm going to present it in Italy for a prize at Macro, and it will be a room with this little room with this video projected, and then the Ouija board. How you pronounce it? Ouija. Ouija.
Yeah.
The board will be transforming to the space. So you will have all the letters, yes, no, arrivederci. I like what is written on this wood table, because the alphabet represents the necessity of reformulating an alphabet. So it's a totally different character. So what the heroines are completely different. No, there are anarchist drug dealers, then there are yes, they are enemy, but I like to give them a position, mm-hmm. a different position. Why they should be always the antagonist? They can be protagonists. And yes, no, and also this arrivederci, that means to see you in hell. And indeed, the ghost represents the fear of society. So the fear that the bourgeois society has towards a certain phenomena. That are those that I've tried to embody, but with joy and with pain or guilt. And this is another work that was dedicated to Eusapia in 2011. This is more a kind of documentary about her work, but this is presented like if the conference was floating in the space and using some tricks. This is an old work of mine, The Criminal Woman, but I really, really like it. Because I like Eusapia, so this is the material together. Ah, this is Eusapia reenacting another piece of mine. That is a reading of Valerie Solanas, that was the author of Scam Manifesto. That is a very, very interesting text. It's a kind of a parody of a certain political manifesto, but it's against macho culture. And but it becomes even much more right-winged than macho culture, this is Scam Manifesto. And when I read it, and indeed I won an important prize with that, I did it from my kitchen. And I took inspiration by, I skipped this. This is about BDSM, I don't want to open this.
Did you mention Andy Warhol at all?
No, but indeed I made this work. This is the video at Mozart. Within the context of a very, very important institutional prize in Italy. So mm-hmm. I really liked the idea that the enemy of Andy Warhol is competing for a prize, and indeed,
yeah.
We won it. I think she was a genius, Solanas, a genius. Then, of course, if one takes literally what she writes, of course, it's absurd, but if you have the brain to pay attention on how she constructed this manifesto and everything, I find it an amazing literary piece. They really needed to be presented again. And when I did it, I took inspiration by the first program of Berlusconi, when he decided from the media to enter politics. Now, here you see how he This is very, very famous seminar video, because the a person that owned the TV station, main TV station, so the person who made you believe that reality is what you could see on a screen, decided to enter politics. And he did it, this was in 96,
yes,
presenting his own program to save Italy from communism. And he presented his program speaking from his house, you see? Here he's speaking about, this is an act where you are taking advantage of everything you've been doing, because people even of a certain age are following your television and are starting to believe what you say.
Mm-hmm.
And not only I do this, I do this kind of violence to media, but also I announce it from my house with the photos of my family behind and my books. I mean, I found that this, the context of this declaration, this comfort, I mean, it's like if we are we friends, that you show up from your house, that, I mean, now you're going to take Italy. And so I was very, very fascinated by that. But so since I wasn't presenting neither religious, neither family value, so I made it myself with the text behind me, then the kitchen of my table, then these are books of theosophy, which are not related at all. on the left there is this little collage of the King Kong woman. And I read Solanas, but now I don't know if it's, is this?
Yeah. Do you research much on psychoanalysis and consciousness, like, because a lot of the characters, like Valerie, they're sort of put as mentally ill or schizophrenic.
Well,
and I guess this relates to these ideas of the demons and...
Well, I'm not into psychoanalysis, but I'm into hypnosis.
Mm-hmm.
Then I don't know if she was crazy, Valerie Solanas. Indeed, we never think about the fact that at the time, at the factory, people were taking a lot of drugs. There have been a lot of accidents, suicides. It was something common at the time. It was like living over the top. And she was just one of the person involved in that thing. And then there was a fight with Andy Warhol, and this act of killing. Sincerely, I think she wanted to injure him. I don't think she would have really killed him, but still, I'm no one to that I can judge him.
Yeah.
What I know is that the text she wrote is one, for me, is like the female descent. And should need much more space, because the fact that you have committed a crime against another person, as there have been a lot of crime in the history of literature, art, in the history of drugs, in the history of music. So it's not something that, so automatically I commit a crime, and then when I write this amazing book, becomes real at a certain point. She presented this program of the Scam Manifesto as if she was ready to take the country and whatever, but of course it's a product of imagination. A very, very perverted imagination.
Mm-hmm.
But for example, we never take literally the 120 days of Sodom of the Sad. We know that the Sad was a bit of a strange man with some strange habits that indeed took him to commit the crime. So he went to prison, not because of it, if I'm not wrong. Anyway, he committed some crime. Even then, it's about injuring someone. But the 100 Days of Sodom has a totally different treatment. So we consider it a book about, for example, a certain form of revolt. We respect the fact that Juliet, which is the antagonist in the Southern literature, represents the liberated woman that takes advantage of society. So she's a criminal, but she is the one that has a future. So we give good values to that, to this aspect of, unless, I don't know, unless you're a poor like this kind of fundamental, this kind of religious fundamentalist that you can even discuss about the value of literature with them. But at the same time, Solanas for me is a very underrated. So for me, it's like a dessert. Mm-hmm. And I really, really enjoy acting this kind of character. So this, I show you just 1 minute because I think it can be very boring.
The conflict, therefore, is not so between is females and males,
like
but between scum.
It's happening to television.
Dominant, secure, self-confident, nasty, violent, selfish, independent, proud, thrill-seeking, free-wheeling, arrogant females. Respect. To call a man an animal is to flatter him. He's a machine. A walking dildo. Niceness, politeness and dignity. Money, marriage, and prostitution, and becomes a transvestite. He loses his desire to screw or to do anything else, for that matter, double dealers. He fulfills himself as a drag queen and gets his dick chopped off. He then achieves a continuous diffuse sexual feeling from being a woman. Screwing is, for a man, a defense against his desire to be female. Competition. Life in this society being at best not a bore, and no aspect of society being at all relevant to women, there remains to civic-minded, responsible, thrill-seeking females, only to overthrow the government, eliminate the money system, institute a complete automation and destroy the male sex and bust them up. Disgust, guilt, shame, doubt. And moreover, he is aware of what he is and what he isn't. Disease and death. Rapist. Politicians. Lousy singers and musicians. Chairman of boards, landlords, great artists. What will liberate women, therefore, from male control is the total elimination of the money work system, not the attainment of economic equality with men within it. Disc jockeys. The male is a biological accident. The male gene is an incomplete female gene, that is, it has an incomplete set of chromosomes. In other words, the male is an incomplete female. Psychiatrist and clinical psychologist. Men who tell it like it is, who put women straight, who reveal the truth about themselves, who give mindless male-female. Correct sentences to parrot, who tell them a woman's primary goal in life should be to squash the male sex. Men who speak when they have nothing to say. Men who sit idly on the street and mark the landscape with their presence. And nice, passive, accepting, cultivated. Polite, dignified, subdued, dependent, scared, mindless, insecure, approval seeking. Daddy's girls. Men who in the slightest way arm any female, scum will become members of the unwoke force, the fuck up force. They will get jobs of various kinds of unwork. For example, scum sales girls will not charge for merchandise. Scum telephone operators will not charge for calls. Eliminate men and women will shape up. Women are improvable, men are no, although their behavior is. But scum is too impatient to wait for the brainwashing of millions of assholes. Great art and culture, formal education, ignorance, social and economic classes, simultaneously with a fucking up, looting, a couple busting, destroying, killing scum will recruit. When genetic control is possible, and soon it will be, it goes without saying that we should produce only all complete beings, not physical defects of deficiency, such as madness. Scum, then, will consist of recruiters, the elite corps, the hardcore activists, the fuck-ups, looters and destroyers, and then the elite of the elite, the killers. What daddy is, it could affect a total submission of males to female. But scum, the society for cutting up men, is impatient. The sick, irrational men, those who attempt to defend themselves against their disgustingness, when they see scum barreling down on them, will cling in terror to Big Mama with their big and bouncy boobies. But boobies won't protect them against scum. Daddy's girl, always tense and fearful, uncool, who can't cope with the unknown, who want to hang back with the apes. A small handful of scum can take over the country within a year by systematically fucking up the system, selectively destroying property and murder. Not fully responsive, half-dead, trivial, dull, conventional. Daddy's girl always tense and fearful, uncool, unanalytical, lacking objectivity, appraises daddy and thereafter other men against a background of fear. Respect. Who, lacking sense, imagination, can have value only in a male society, only as soothers, ego boosters, relaxers, and breeders. Who are dismissed as inconsequent. Scum consists of individuals. Scum is not a mob, it's a blob. In a sane society, the male will trot along obediently after the female. The male is docile and easily led, easily subjected to the domination of any female who cares to dominate him. But when scum gets hot on their asses, it'll shape up fast. No genuine social...
So in general, is it, I really suggest to read the book, Scum Manifesto. It's about misandering, but it's amazing. The first time when I had it, the first page I was laughing with my crying for the laugh, and still it happens. So this is a kind of a cut out of the reading. Mm-hmm. And the installation takes inspiration from the PowerPoint presentation. So I become one part of the PowerPoint with this text in my house written behind me. And now it's going to, now is an exhibition in, now it's going to Macba in Barcelona. And yes, in Italy it was a bit of a scandal because it was so good, my performance, that they took it literally. even because the funny thing was, in this prize, all the rest of the artists were male. So it's also, why not exercise in competition? Like this, I mean, why I am supposed to be politically correct? I'm completely incorrect, but also with a lot of irony. And so I think it's nice.
How does this function differently when you do it live for yourself. It must be much more intense.
I have to say, this one, I really prefer the video version.
Mm-hmm.
Because it's also about the shock of finding this kind of video. I imagine someone who goes into a museum, and then at a certain point, you are surrounded by all these mottos about against society. I have also to specify that some parts of this manifesto are totally rational. Some parts, like, for example, that women should try to remove from the workforce. I mean, there are certain parts that are very interesting. But then there is a lot of political incorrectness, a form of Nazism against men. So it's a way of retelling the story of women in macho culture, but from the other point of view. And I think about the surprise of someone who is going into the museum, it's also connected with education, and you find something that is miseducation. And how did you end up in an institutional context like that? This thing makes me very happy. I really love this kind of putting these things into institutions, collaborating with institutions, with this context, it's a form of probably perversion. I don't know. It excites me a lot. And so, and I know the live version. In the live version, I basically read the text I'm reading here, which is a selection.
Mm-hmm.
But I prefer not to do it. I've done it. The first time I did it with the PowerPoint presentation behind me, with all this picture of monkeys, like the Planet of the Apes, which also is very incorrect to use animal to represent the male gender. But after the first time, the first time I did it, that was occasionally during Documenta, but this was not part of Documenta. I decided to transform that experience into a video installation. And I really like the power of video in this context, because it gives a lot of authority to the, this was the preparation of it. It gives authority that you enter a room and there is a projector. So the museum is paying a technology and someone who paints this. And I don't know, I really, really like this. But then there is, yes, sometimes I've done a live version, but I'm not a fan of that. In that case, the people, the public, are really worried to have someone that can be crazy in front of
them. Do you keep the pace in this kind of narcotic quick way when you do it live?
Yeah, I would say yes.
Yeah.
But I try to engage. It depends. But I prefer the video version. In this since it was a very very publicized, and I was asked to make stills of that video, not so for the private market. And I decided to ask other characters from the characters that you've seen in the Book of Evil Spirit are reenacting this video in a photo. So you cannot own a still of that thing, but counterfeit documentation. And then to say, this was, they circulated a lot, this work. And this is Dogaressa Querini Parien. This is a portrait from this Venice palace. So since in the performance, it was me doing the guide in the museum, and I was talking next to painting of women, then putting again myself, the picture wouldn't have been anything. So there is this Renaissance Dogaressa is reading the book, and then the woman that takes drugs, dope head is there, and she cannot stand the performance. The Eusapia has the table is flying, and then Erudini, I don't speak of Erudini today, and this is the killers painting. So the capitalist artist with the assistants that are painting her program. This image I also really, really like. Scum elite. And this is still my assistant here next to me. and the maxi, these are just the souvenir photos of our... Ah, here I was asked to do this kind of live thing, so I included also Solanas with the book. But it's different. It's just me reading that. Not with nothing written behind.
I have a question about the video. How important is it to like recreate a historical setting? Like in the video, there's kind of a lot of like strictly 19th century punctos, and I just wonder how like if there's a specific reason why it's so like translated almost like one to one to the time frame where these texts and these characters were living or.
Well, for example, the ball represents the future,
mm-hmm.
and the Ouija represents the past, because with one you speak with the dead, and the other one you speak to the future. Then, no, it's also a way of playing with the reconstruction, because it's not really 19th century.
No, of course,
I'm wearing a wig. That shirt comes from second-hand shop. It's... imagining the life of Eusapia. And also I like the fact that in the tradition of this kind of psychic, when they had to perform something, they were using the things they had in their house. So for example, a certain kind of glue in order to make the ghost, or a certain paper, like a collage. I just want to underline certain a tradition, but not a counter-cultural tradition, obviously. But then Ulrike Meinhof is not in the style of... It's how I feel.
Mm-hmm.
I also like that style.
Mm-hmm.
So it's also a personal thing.
I have something related. I don't know if it's probably not a question. Remark, maybe I cannot formulate it. I was thinking about this.
What is this?
Should I?
Yeah. Do the question and then I tell you what is this.
Okay. The I was wondering. I couldn't kind of figure out, but it's about the setting, but it's also about the reenacting some figure and the kind of the power of the method of reenactment. And I couldn't really like distinguish in what moments. It got really powerful, and the moments where the kind of almost through the humor or doing the stereotype, reproducing the stereotype, where it also like kind of went, it started to annoy me, like, but it got also to your humor, like being ridiculous in a way, you know. And that I was like, I was asking, do I now like the person or not? I mean, the figure that is reenacted, or like, what is? And I don't know. I mean, the last piece I really liked because it was a mixture. Also, you had like the Berlusconi setting, and then you actually had a voice of somebody's totally from a different point of view, or.
Uh-huh.
Maybe we can make a connection. So,
yeah,
I don't know. Maybe it's something about showing the stereotype.
Yeah,
like, what
definitely.
Is the power of that, or how do you deal with it? Like,
I show the stereotype.
Yeah.
I show it. It's a strategy. It's a strategy. And I also like to keep the public in a position of, and now this time I thought, right now I prefer more to do lectures about what I've done, but in general I do performance lectures, and during the performance lecture people get very, very nervous, because sometimes I put them on different, I cannot say vibration, I will turn into someone's new age, which I'm not, but it's a way. I also like to include irony into something very tragical,
mm-hmm.
and this is also a retelling of things. So I took the responsibility of telling you how I constructed this video because I also wanted to tell you what happened before. But someone who sees it does not. I mean, I could see a witch that is talking about against culture, then a woman with a mask might be, maybe I see on a press release that is Ulrike Mainz, maybe she's not. So, different layers, obviously. And also, yes, I like this being pedantic, I say. This kind of fake educational thing. I really enjoy it. Because it's like with mixing music in the jam, you know? You have this peak, and then it goes down, and when this thing goes down, you enter with another record. So I've been working as this jockey before. And I always search for this structure in the narration of them. Then I'm absolutely aware that Eusapia is a very static, this one is very static film. But also for me it makes a lot of sense. And here, when I did this, when I won this competition, Fondazione Furla promoted my work. So here you see a collage with the, this is the text of the terrorist. That became the background for the bags. And the bags were in style with the collage. And I like it very much. You are putting this information and this totally different approach into something that you would never expect to embrace. And yes, this is more. I'm more someone like someone who moves in from other angles. I participate to the struggle, but in a different way. Yeah, and I like contradictions and all this. Ah, this is very important. Said this now, it's over. Karl Marx tried to join the forces of this army of Lumpen, but while he was shouting Egalité, the woman possessed as head shot. This is from a text that my friend Francesco Bano Ragazzi wrote about me. And here I think this is the exercise. Ha ha ha.